Hi, my name is Billy and welcome back to my shop. Today I'm going to show you how I made this awesome plaid end grain cutting board. And stick around to the end of the video because I'm going to show you how to apply a finish that doesn't involve mineral oil. I've received multiple requests on how to make a plaid cutting board. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to use all domestic species and this is what we're going to do. We are going to use some oak. We are also going to have some cherry and some maple to make all of our squares. And then we will use some walnut to do the actual stripes within the plaid. First step is start milling lumber down. I milled up all the material and I planed all the pieces down to about 7/8 of an inch thick. But then when I cut it to the table saw, I actually cut these strips a little bit thicker than that. And that's gonna give me a little bit of meat on the bone. So when I glue up these panels, I'm gonna glue them in separate batches here, I've got a little bit more thickness and then I can plane this down nice and flat. Then when you look at it from the end, you're gonna see a perfect 7/8 of an inch square. We have two batches here, alternating pattern, cherry, oak, and so on, and then oak, maple, and so on. We'll glue these together in separate groups, and then we'll plane it down flat. Once it's all ready to go, we'll cut it into slices, and those slices are gonna be whatever the thickness of the cutting board is gonna be, plus a little bit extra. So in my case, I want my cutting board to be about 1.5 inches thick, so I'm gonna cut my slices around 1¾ inches. That'll give us a little bit of room because once we glue all these pieces back together again, we're gonna have to flatten it and we're gonna want that extra space. I cut all the slices and when we put it together, we have this really cool plaid pattern. So what I've got is alternating sections oak and maple, and then cherry and oak. Oak and maple, cherry and oak, and so on. And I really like how this looks. So the next step is we're gonna glue all of this together. And to do this, I'm gonna make it easy on myself. I'm actually gonna use a jig. I threw this together. This is simply some particle board, a fence, and then I made a separate one as a call. So what I can do is put all of my pieces into my jig, reference it against my fence. I can now clamp the call this way against my board to make sure that all my little squares line up, and then I can put clamps here on the ends too. And with all that clamping pressure, it's possible for the center area to bulge a little bit. So to stop that, I'll put a couple calls across the top and then clamp it this way. So we're gonna get clamping pressure across all surfaces of this cutting board. Now, we still gonna have to flatten this thing once it's all dry, but by doing all of this work, it's gonna save us a lot of work later on whenever we do have to surface the board. This is all dry and it looks phenomenal. Yeah, so really you could leave it just like this and just have a really cool looking cutting board. But I want this to be traditional plaid, which means I need stripes. All of the areas that have the maple in it, I want to slice those. That's this way and this way. All these maple areas will get sliced. And to do that, I'm going to use the table saw. So I want to make sure this board is as flat as possible. And I'm gonna put 1/8 inch thick walnut stripes in here. That's because my table saw blade is a full kerf 1/8 inch thick blade. And then whenever I glue all this back together, I won't lose any dimensions to this. All of those squares will be the same size as the rest of the squares. So now we have to flatten this board. Well, how do we do that? Well, one way to do it is to use a flattening jig like this. So this is just a piece of plywood with a couple fences that I tacked on here, and then I also made a 90 degree square. And you can take your cutting board, stick it in here, and then take another piece that you can put your router into, and you can ride it across and move your router back and forth until you flatten the entire top, flip it over, and then do it again. You can sand it. This is the most common method, I think, for people because they may not have a lot of different tools. I will put on some heavy duty grit, 40 grit, 60 grit, whatever it is. Take a pencil, scribble it all over this thing, put on some headphones and some music, sand it all down so that pencil line is gone. Then you can also take it and flip it over, put it on something flat like a table saw surface, just to make sure that you're sanding it nice and even, and then find out if it is flat. One cheap method you could use, if you have a bandsaw that has a big enough capacity to it, once you sand one side, you could resaw the other side flat and then sand it all up until the blade marks are gone. The planer. I don't recommend using this tool to flatten your ingrain cutting board. I just don't find that running ingrain through a planer is the safest operation for me. That's why I recommended using one of the other operations as an alternative. I'm going to use the CNC. This is a new tool in my shop, so I'm excited to use it for this application. Usually I've done the sanding method, I've done the router sled method, so I want to check this out and flatten it with the CNC, see how easy that is. The cutting board is flat and it looks phenomenal. Really, we could keep it just like this, but I still think it needs those plaid stripes. So what I did was took a whole bunch of walnut and milled it down to 1/8 inch thick. And that is the same thickness as my table saw blade. So the next step is to cut the stripes. And I'm gonna do that right here at the table saw. Where all of the maple is, I'm gonna slice that right down the middle. So I'll start doing it long ways, cut all of these, and in between each piece, we'll put a piece of walnut, and then we will glue all of this together and let it dry. Then we'll have to sand or plane all of this back down so it's nice and flat, turn it sideways, and do the same thing. Where there's maple, we're gonna slice it again, and then put a bunch more of these in there, glue it back up together. This looks fantastic. And just like I said last time, we could just stop right here and it would look amazing. But I'm gonna add another set of stripes. We're gonna turn it sideways, cut it this way, add more walnut, glue it back together. That will be our last glue up. Just finished up the last flattening and it looks amazing. It's exactly what I was looking for when it comes to the pattern. So now it's time for all those finishing touches. So what I'm gonna do is buzz off the edges so it gets nice and clean, sand away some of these mill marks and get it really flat. And then I'm thinking maybe a slight bevel towards the bottom here just so it's easier to pick up. I spent a couple hours sanding this down all the way up to 220 grit. It took a little bit of time because it's ingrain, and ingrain just takes a long time to sand, but I love the way it turned out. So now it is time to apply finish to it. This is the most controversial part of this video or any video you ever watch when it comes to a cutting board. And that is, people have really strong opinions on what is food safe. The most common method that people use is soaking it in mineral oil and applying wax. And that is absolutely fine. I've used it plenty of times. The downside is mineral oil never dries. So your board can kind of weep mineral oil from time to time. I'm gonna go a little bit different. I'm gonna apply salad bowl finish. And anybody who's used salad bowl finish might be yelling at their device right now saying, you can't use that because it applies a film. If you think of ingrain, ingrain is like a whole bunch of straws. And you pour liquid into those straws, they're gonna fill it up. So what I wanna do is I'm gonna thin this down. I'm gonna flood the surface and let all of this stuff soak into my board. But I'm gonna make sure I wipe it off so that there's no film that builds on the surface. Let it dry. Tomorrow, sand the thing down and do it again. And after a couple coats of that, then all the pores of the wood should be nice and filled with the salad bowl finish. It should be nice and hard. It should resist water seeping in. Then I can apply wax to the outside surface of it. And I think that's gonna make, for me at least, a durable finish. The key to all this though is I need to thin my salad bowl finish so that it is as thin as possible so that it soaks into the pores as quick as possible so I don't build that film on the surface. And to thin it, I have to use mineral spirits. And again, some people might get upset by that because mineral spirits is not food safe. But in this application, mineral spirits is going to flash off, it's going to evaporate. And we know that wood bowl finish, salad bowl finish is a food safe product. But if you look up the MSDS sheet on this, you'll find that a big component of this is mineral spirits. So that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna mix it up. I'm gonna do about a half to half ratio, flood the surface, let it soak in, make sure I wipe off the surfaces so it doesn't build a film, set it up on its edge, let it dry. I'll come back tomorrow and do it again. I'm gonna use a foam brush to apply it. I just wanna get as much in there as I can so it can soak it up. And now we get to see that grain pop. You'd already see all of the bubbles where the stuff is just soaking in. And all I'm doing right now is kind of moving the stuff on the surface from the areas where it hasn't soaked in to the areas that it has. We can see if it's been soaking in by looking at the bottom, and yep, you can start to see some spots forming underneath there. Wonder why people have such strong feelings about finishes. I devoted an entire segment of a video that I made on 5 things that woodworkers overthink. And at least one of those topics I talked about finishing and people really overcomplicating finishing. I'm gonna get so many angry comments about this. Before I decided on this finish, I did some research. And that's what I always tell people to do is please research stuff because it doesn't matter what you do, someone's gonna tell you you're doing it the wrong way. So all you can do is educate yourself on it. And even still, with all of that and all of my research and knowing what works best for me and my decisions, there will still be people who say, no way in the world will I cook with a cutting board that has mineral spirits on it. That's fine. That is absolutely up to them. What they probably don't realize is that they're eating on a kitchen table that is finished with a polyurethane or a lacquer. And I'm sure some point a chip or a French fry fell on it and they ate it and they didn't die. The great majority of finishes are food safe after they're fully cured. That's typically 30 days. So what I'm gonna do is make sure I wipe all of this extra off. I don't want to have any extra on the surface, but even still, Tomorrow, I'm gonna come back in here and I'm gonna take my sander and sand this entire thing with 220 grit. And then I'll apply another coat, and I should not need near as much. And then I'll sand it again and then apply a third coat. Make sure that I wipe off any of the areas that have the face grain. Because again, I don't wanna have a film built, even though I don't think anybody chops vegetables or meat on the side of the cutting board. That'd be kind of weird. Maybe psychopaths. Same people who eat hot dogs sideways, they chop using the side of the cutting board. I love the way this cutting board turned out. It was a ton of work, but also a ton of fun. And if you're interested in building a cutting board, maybe give this pattern a shot. If you like this sort of content, please subscribe and give this video a like. I'd really appreciate it. And until we meet again, get in your shop and build something awesome.